Hello and welcome to Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rehman, and our guest today is a promising young man from Northern Virginia who has run for offices and also is a former Marine. Atif Qarni would be talking about his reaction on President Obama's State of the Union address and also lots of other issues. Welcome, Atif. Thank you very much
for
joining us here at VOA. Please let us know about your reaction. Just like that. I mean, watched him?
I watched him last night, and I really enjoyed the State of the Union address, his last address. He did a really good job in talking about what he has done in the last 7 years and really what his legacy is about. I think it was very strong, very strongly delivered. One of the things he really emphasized is that there are misconceptions from other politicians that America is somehow getting weaker, militarily or economically, but he emphasized that, hey, we are still the strongest superpower in the world. Our economy is getting stronger, and we've had great run in the last 2 years. So he did a very good job in emphasizing that, and I really enjoyed his speech.
Atif, you're an ex-Marine, and you have served in Iraq.
Yes.
An Iraq veteran, actually. Mm-hmm. So what's your take on his assessment of the security situation? Mm-hmm. And also, what do you think, he's been criticized heavily mm-hmm. by his opponents and actually by some of his friends,
right,
that he has had two hands-off approach mm-hmm. towards the issues, especially in the Middle East. Mm-hmm. What do you think, as an ex-Marine, mm-hmm. Was he convincing in assuring the American people that yes, America is secure and America is engaged in the world affairs?
I think a lot of the criticism that he received is unfair. He's, in my opinion, he's doing the best as possible to keep Americans safe, which is a number one priority for everyone, and it should be. Unfortunately, with the with ISIS emerging and we've seen terrorist attacks on our soil, it is tough, because when an act of terrorism happens, you naturally question that, hey, where did we fall short? Where did our government fall short? Having said that, in my opinion, compared to prior administrations, he has done a very good job in really trying to bring the international community together to battle things like terrorism. But the situation in the Middle East is so complex that it goes back hundreds of years. And that's something that unfair to hold one administration accountable that, hey, they can fix the whole mess. That is something that a lot of the Muslim countries themselves have to work out what's happening in the Middle East.
Atif, you're a very unique person. You're an ex-Marine. You're an Iraq veteran. You are Muslim.
Yes.
And you have run for offices in Northern Virginia,
yes,
and the part which is supposed to be a conservative part of the county and of the state, and also as a Democrat.
Yes.
So these are all very, very unique factors and attributes, so to speak. So what do you think is going on when he said about, he didn't mention Mr. Donald Trump's name,
mm-hmm.
but of course there was a reference made to Muslims,
yes,
and other minorities. How did you see that?
Yeah, I really appreciated the president talking mm-hmm. about that. What good leadership is that sometimes you have to make statements that might not be popular, that people may not want to hear, but they're the right thing to do. And in that instance, when he mentioned that, hey, we should not, we should really put our preconceived notions aside, and we're all Americans, and when he referenced the Muslim American community, that really touched my heart, and I know that it touched probably millions of other Americans who are Muslim or friends with a lot of the Muslims who feel that way, that they have that the Muslim American community has been unfairly targeted by folks like Donald Trump and other politicians who are making statements to really, because there's an election going on and they really want to energize a certain faction in our country to come out and vote for them. And what the president did, it may not seem very popular, but I think it was very courageous of him to say that reference and really remind Americans what true American values are.
Another important link that you have with this situation is you're from Prince William County.
Yes.
The chairman of the county is a Republican, a staunch Republican,
yes.
Corey Stewart.
Yes.
Who happens to be representing Mr. Donald Trump
yes.
in Virginia.
Yes.
Right. I think he's going to take care of his
campaign chairman
for Donald Trump in,
yes.
in Virginia. Virginia being a very important. Still a swing state,
yes,
right?
It is.
It could be either way next elections. I mean, you know, in this year's elections. You wrote an article about Mr. Stewart, Mr. Corey Stewart, joining Donald Trump's campaign.
Yes.
But you maintain a very fine line between xenophobia and his politics.
Mm-hmm.
Do you really believe that so much rancor and so much noise that you hear mm-hmm. about Muslims and other minorities,
mm-hmm.
does it really represent the feelings of the American people, or is it has to do more with the politics of the day, or just, you know, getting higher in the ratings?
Well, I think it's a combination of both things, and the president actually referenced that as well, is that some of the and when he was implying that some of the folks, his colleagues in politics who are part of the Republican Party, they do feel that they've been hijacked by their base, who feels very strongly, and their fear that they might lose their seat. In my opinion, when I wrote the op-ed
in the Washington Post
mm-hmm. about Corey Stewart, in my personal opinion, he's not xenophobic.
He's not racist.
I've actually spoken on a panel with him. It was about the community's involvement with the local law enforcement. Different police commissioners spoke on there. I spoke on there. Corey spoke on there. I've had conversations with him. I know he's actually very close to the Muslim community.
I have seen him, you know, at quite a few functions. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Having said that, he is trying to tap into the surge that Donald Trump has amongst certain faction of voters, and they're a big chunk of them in Virginia, in the Commonwealth. There's a big chunk of them in Prince William County. And whether Donald Trump wins or not, gets the nomination or not, Corey feels that, hey, he can tap into those folks and they'll remember that, hey, he stood up for Donald Trump while other establishment folks did not. Another point I wanted to make is that not just on the Republican side, but recently when with the debate over Syrian refugees, actually there were 47 Democrats in Congress that voted to put a stop to Syrian refugees, and some of the Democratic congressmen, in one of them being in Northern Virginia, also, received a lot of, heat from his base, from Democratic base, when they saw his vote go the other way, and they were really, really shocked about that. So I do feel that there is a very polarized view on many things, mm-hmm. including...
And across the board, it's not just the Republican Party or one group.
Yeah.
Okay. That reminds me of something that you wrote for the Washington Post
yes.
when you failed to get the Democratic nomination
that is correct.
For the Senate race,
yes.
The state Senate race.
Yes.
And basically, you just criticized the Democratic Party mm-hmm. leadership for not standing up with you because you being a Muslim...
Right.
And from a minority community,
yeah.
and in your opinion, what I read was that mm-hmm. you thought your chances were less than the other candidate
right.
who used to be quote unquote like a mainstream or a minority candidate.
Yeah.
So you see that problem in the other parties and mm-hmm. other groups as well, not just Republican Party.
I do, and not just my example, but I know of several other examples in Prince William County historically, and actually even after me when there were general elections, I've seen that with the African American candidates who have not got full party support from the leadership. Now, I want to make, there is a difference between establishment and non-establishment. A lot of the grassroots folks, they get excited about a candidate, they door knock and so forth, but a lot of the resources are controlled by a few individuals, and who are making calculations. Again, in my opinion, within the Democratic Party, I didn't feel any xenophobia or Islamophobia. That wasn't the case. There was a calculation made that, hey, it presents a risk. You live in an area where it's possible that it presents a risk that, given the you know, current events that we face with terrorism, that it's possible that you may lose or you might jeopardize a very important seat if we have a Muslim candidate running. That doesn't mean that there are not opportunities elsewhere. I mean, there are many opportunities elsewhere, but you know, Muslims like me who have been active, who are working hard, we want to be the face of the party. We want to be influential. We want to run for seats that really are meaningful, so we can, you know, impact policy. I was focused on education, and I really wanted to focus on that. And unfortunately, the party denied that opportunity because, again, they're not xenophobic or Islamophobic, but they just did not want to take that risk. And I've noticed the same trend with Hispanic American candidates and African American candidates in the county I live in.
But Atif, it was an election, right? Even though you lost the election,
By 225 votes.
Yes, you know, just by very few votes.
Yes.
So, but basically, you still complain that the establishment of the party didn't put their weight behind you.
I asked them to be neutral. Mm-hmm. I said, hey, if you do not want to support me, that's completely okay. Just stay neutral. What they ended up doing was they took a lot of, you know, their resources and they put it behind the other individual.
Mm-hmm.
That being the white Christian male, because there was three candidates running, myself, another actually elected official who was African American, who had actually been elected. He was the only one elected. The other two individuals who were the front runners, myself and the other gentleman who ended up winning, were not even elected officials. So the problem I had was that, hey, we asked for neutrality, that, hey, please stay out, let the person work hard, everybody work hard and prove themselves and see how they can really run a well campaign. And all three of us did a very good job, but where the balance shifted was that where the establishment poured in a lot of money in the prototypical,
okay.
Yes, exactly. And that's what the problem I had.
Mm-hmm. So basically, are you happy that you still ran and had a big impact? You got a lot of votes.
Yes. I have no regrets whatsoever because, you know, we have to continue to pave the way because it's my hope and dream that eventually more and more Muslims, and it doesn't have to be, they don't have to necessarily run for office, but they take more of a leadership role in meaningful, impactful position. We do have a lot of Muslims rising in their careers in different areas of government or private sectors, and you know, I want to see that. I see no reason why in about two decades from now or even sooner we can't have serious Muslim candidates running for president. Mm-hmm. When the comments that Ben Carson or Donald Trump made about, hey, they don't see Islamic values aligning with the U.S. Constitution, I disagree with that because true Islamic values and the purity of the religion, I think they're no different than any other religion. And, it's a very democratic, they're very progressive. And it's my hope and dream that, you know, at least by my kids' generation, that we do have a president in the country that happens to be Muslim and American who, understands those values.
Atif, you're a teacher. Again, you're an ex-Marine. You have served in Iraq in a major U.S. war. And you're also like doing lots of other stuff, coaching, teaching, and everything. So once we come back, we have to take a short break here.
Okay.
Once we come back, we're going to talk to you about all the other parts of your personality.
Sure.
The other aspects, the other activities that you get involved in.
Thank you.
Please stay with us. We'll be right back.
This is not just about the Muslim American community. There is a portion of the American community within our country at large that has a lot of negative sentiments towards Hispanic Americans when it comes to the issue of immigration. They have negative sentiments against African Americans, against the LGBT community, against the Muslim communities. And one of the things that I discussed with Dr. Reed is that these are not isolated things. These are all connected.
Welcome back. I'm Faiz Rehman and you're watching Cafe DC. Our guest today is Atif Qarni, an ex-Marine and a teacher. Atif, once again, thank you again for joining us. Let's talk about your family.
Okay.
Your wife, Fatima.
Yes.
She also seems to be very active in the media and in your campaign. She has written mm-hmm. some beautiful articles about her own experiences as a Muslim American woman.
Yes.
She's again biracial.
Yes.
I think her mother was white and her
father's from Iran, yes.
Your dad is an Iranian. So both of you have so much energy, political energy, so to speak, in the house, and you have two beautiful sons, right?
Yes.
So give us a little, we just want to feel how does your household look like when mm-hmm. you're with your kids, with your wife?
Yeah.
What do you talk about?
We talk about normal day things that any family would. I think every family is unique, but also they're also very similar. My kids play too many video games, so I always have to remind them.
Just like
you need more, need to yeah. burn off some energy by going outside and playing. We have, you know, we have busy lives. Kids have, they're more busy in their social life mm-hmm. than my wife and my myself are. She works for the Department of Energy. She's very involved. She's been with the federal government for close to 15 years, 3 years as a contractor and 12 years with the Department of Energy. And like her, many other Muslims or, you know, our friends who we know are active in all types of different private and public sectors. So
how did you two meet? You're a Pakistani-American,
yeah.
traditional Pakistani family.
I know
your dad, your mother is a very famous poet in America.
Yes.
Actually, she has written, you know, quite a few books.
Yes.
Your dad has been very active in yes. local politics.
Yes.
And Fatima is mm-hmm. from a totally different background.
Yeah.
So talk about some arranged marriages and love marriages. What happened here?
Yeah, it was definitely not arranged. Mm-hmm. We met at George Washington when we were both in our undergraduate, mm-hmm. Doing our undergraduate degree. And actually, I happen to be from a Sunni background. She mm-hmm. happens to be from a Shia background, which is interesting. But we didn't really talk about that. Mm-hmm. It just happened. Mm-hmm. We were friends for a few months prior to.
So how this Saudi-Iranian conflict is playing out in your family?
It's we discuss it. We discuss mm-hmm. those things because over the years, after we have grown up and become more mature, mm-hmm. We see a world from a different perspective. We analyze it much more, in depth. Both of us, neither one of us, were really involved in politics. It's the last 3 years, given our situation, me being a teacher and seeing the issues with education, I got involved. She is a commuter. She commutes into D.C., so mm-hmm. she's frustrated with those issues. So those two things
like
were...
Like 3 hours commute every day,
yeah,
I guess,
so
right?
Yeah, it's about an hour and a half. And mm-hmm. she takes the VRE, and she used mm-hmm. to drive in. Now she takes the VRE. And so those two things were the biggest things that we discussed mm-hmm. all the time. I talked about mm-hmm. education all the time. She talked about her frustrations with commuting mm-hmm. from all the...
Atif, let me ask you this, and this question is on everybody's mind basically these days about Muslims and the Muslim community and
yes.
even the American Muslim community, mm-hmm. those who were born and raised here.
Yes.
You are a quintessential mm-hmm. American family.
Yes.
You represent America.
Yes.
In some ways, you represent the American dream. You know, mm-hmm. not too many people get to do stuff that you have done
right.
in, you know, such a young, at such a young age. And your wife too. Mm-hmm. So where is this, malaise? Where did it come from? Why why such a negative stereotype about the Muslim community?
Mm-hmm.
Whose fault is that? I mean, do you think the Muslim American community hasn't done enough mm-hmm. to educate their neighbors, their friends, mm-hmm. Their coworkers? Mm-hmm. You know, what's going on? Why there's so much negativity mm-hmm. about Muslims in America? Why Mr. Trump is basically gaining in ratings
right.
by attacking Muslims?
Right.
Why? Is it also a responsibility of the Muslim community, not just here but around the world?
Mm-hmm. I had an opportunity to speak, and I often consult with a gentleman named Dr. William Ferguson Reed, who was the first African American elected to Virginia General Assembly in 1968. He is 90 years old now. He lives in Chevy Chase, and I often talk to him. And one of the things, the conversations I had with him is that this is not just about the Muslim American community. There is a portion of the American community within our country at large that has a lot of negative sentiments towards Hispanic Americans when it comes to the issue of immigration. They have negative sentiments against African Americans, against the LGBT community, against the Muslim communities. And one of the things that I discussed with Dr. Reed is that these are not isolated things. These are all connected. So that's the thing that Muslim Americans have to understand. For our purposes, specifically for Muslim Americans, that negative sentiment, the combination of that, and unfortunately the combination of terrorism with ISIS and Al-Qaeda and other groups, that's created that negative toxic culture. As far as what Muslim Americans need to do, I think we already do it. I think there's a lot of folks who are involved in philanthropic activities through either privately or through mosques. There's a lot of folks who are in the medical services field who provide great service.
Doctors, engineers, teachers, professors, yeah.
There's coaches. Yes, coach football, track and field. So we're
and players, comedians,
yes,
actors, Hollywood,
media,
absolutely.
Everything. So when folks say, hey, well, Muslims are not assimilating and so forth, I think we are assimilating. My definition of assimilation is not that you have to sacrifice your religious principles by doing certain things. We are.
And you're a classic example of that. I mean, I see, and a lot of your voters, and your neighbors, your students, they see you as an American person. Right there. With all the espousing all the American values and posture, games and everything, but at the same time, America, or for that matter, any civilization or any culture wouldn't demand that you leave, you check out your religious beliefs on the door, and then become something that defined by certain attributes. So you're an example, right? That you and your family, and your wife, born and raised American.
Yes.
She takes the scarf, not exactly a hijab, but
she wears a hijab. She wears a hijab.
Okay.
She wears a hijab.
On her own.
On her own accord. Well, when she was growing up in Washington D.C., she started wearing it at the age of 10. Because her older sister started wearing it at the age of 12. And all her sisters, there are five daughters in that family and two boys. So all the girls wore it when they were young. Actually, everybody has left the practice on their own, and they had their own reasons for it. And we respect their reasons. My wife, decided not to. She's always, to her it's a matter of pride. Mm-hmm. And
she wrote a beautiful blog, by the way, on the same subject.
And one of the issues that we're facing with is that there's so many variety of Muslims, women who might wear a scarf or might not, or might wear much more conservative type of clothing. And I think we need to stay away from liberals that, hey, this person might be a liberal Muslim, moderate, conservative Muslims. We're all Muslims. We're part of the big picture. And I think sometimes those labels can be very dangerous, because my wife, who wears a scarf, in her political views, she is very, very liberal, very close to what Bernie Sanders is like. However, if somebody might look at her on the street.
Yeah, and she has raised issues for the gays and lesbian community.
Exactly.
So, exactly, just like any other liberal will do.
Exactly. So that's the thing, is that if you might see her or on the street and you don't know her, you're like, well, this woman is wearing a scarf. She might not be as American. And I think that we're really living in times where folks with these labels, and we're exploring these labels, everybody's trying to get an understanding of it and how we move forward. I think this particular election is really about battling for the soul of America. It's not just about issues of economy or what we do with the military and so forth. It's really about how we're going to move forward, and we're really battling for the soul of America to understand, hey, what our true American values are, and what is it mean to be a true American. Is, in my opinion, I'm as American as it gets, and I'm not a unique. You mentioned that, hey, I might be unique, but I'm not unique to the Muslim community. I think majority of the Muslim Americans are more like myself, that they, in their respective fields, they're very American in what they do. They can practice their religion, but at the same time, they provide a service, and they're patriotic, and they love our country. And that is something that I think that the rest of Americans really need to understand.
Atif, that's a beautiful thought. I wanted to also talk about some other issues, but we're almost, we are out of time. But one last question. Yes. Typically, South Asian families, they yes. want their kids to be doctors, engineers.
Yes.
And you chose teaching.
Yes.
Which is a very unconventional
yes.
Occupation for the South Asian kids and the young people. Mm-hmm. Why did you choose to be a teacher?
When I was in Iraq, I had some time to reflect on what I want to do after I became more serious, you know, as I grew up and everything, and what I wanted my career to be, whether I wanted to focus on making money or actually going into something. My grandfather is a teacher from my dad's side. My grandmother was a teacher from my mother's side. My mother was also in the teaching profession for 15 plus years. I didn't think about ever being a teacher prior to going to Iraq, but it gave me time to reflect on I want to do something more meaningful. And that's why I went into teaching. That's why I really enjoy it, because I feel like that I can really shape young minds to think positively, you know, have big hopes and dreams. I teach in a school which is predominantly African American or Hispanic American. There are a lot of South Asian families there as well. A lot of middle class or working class families, and I want to inspire kids to say, hey, it doesn't matter what your background is, you want to shoot for the stars. Yes, you can be president one day. Yes, you can be a CEO of a big major company one day. You can do whatever you want, because that's the society we live in, as long as you work hard and really stay positive.
Great thoughts, and on these excellent ideas and thoughts, we would like to end our program. Thank you very much.
Thank you
once again
for
joining us. Again, we just tried to basically explain what a regular Muslim guy looks like,
yeah.
and how can you be a good American as well as a good Muslim,
yes.
and actually serve the society and serve the people around you. And in your case, you're doing a wonderful job. Congratulations.
Thank you, Faiz.
Once again, thank you very much for watching Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rehman. So long.